The most intelligent thing that we talk to every day doesn't even have a body. It lives inside our screens. But that might be about to change. If you look back, we've always adopted new technology by giving it a physical form. Electricity became the light bulb, radio waves became the radios, and the internet became smartphones. Now it might be AI's turn. Recently, OpenAI teamed up with legendary designer Jony. The goal? To do the same thing for AI that the iPhone did for the internet. But that brings up a big question. Does AI even need a physical body? I mean, its real power is that it can live anywhere. In the apps, in your phones, in the cloud. So why are we trying so hard to put it into a physical object? Especially when ChatGPT has already gained millions of users without that. And as always, to answer these questions of the future, we have to go back in time and understand the concept of embodiment. Embodiment means giving technology physical form, something people can see, they can touch and interact with. And historically, this step has been very critical for making new technologies accessible for everyone. Think about electricity. It was discovered in the 1800s. But it wasn't a big part of people's lives until Edison manufactured the light bulb. And suddenly, electricity was not just in wires and theories, it was light in your home. Or look at the radio. Radio waves were known for years, but it was the invention of the radio box that made radio popular and brought it into our homes. And then the same thing happened with the computers and the internet. Before the smartphones, the internet lived in the computers. You had to sit at a desk to go online. Then the iPhone gave the internet a physical body, something that you can carry in your pocket. And that changed everything. It made the internet truly personal, truly everywhere. So if you see, there's a clear pattern here. First comes the new technology, then comes the physical embodiment, and finally, mass adoption. Because when technology stays invisible or abstract, only experts use it. But once it's embodied, once it takes a physical form that people can understand, then it goes mainstream. But that's not the case with AI. It has already gone mainstream. ChatGPT got a million users in the first 5 days. That's faster than any tech launch in the history. And now, 500 million people use it every single week. So clearly, AI doesn't need a body to go mainstream. It already has. So then why? Why are we trying so hard to give it a physical body? Here's the thing, it's not about reach anymore, but it's about how we use it. Right now, tools like ChatGPT works like this. You write a prompt, it processes the text and understands the context and gives you a response. But the quality of its answers depends completely on the quality of your prompt. And let's be real, most of us are not writers or narrators, so we don't know how to explain any situation. We forget the details, we skip context, because we just assume that the AI understands what we meant, but it doesn't. And that's why most of the time you get bad answers and then you go back, you rephrase, you put more info, and then it works. You also may have noticed that when you use the advanced O3 or deep research models, it always asks you more information and details so that it can understand the context better. And all of this happens because the current AI has no senses. It can't see the problem, it can't hear your tone, or it can't sense your surroundings. Basically, it's blind, deaf, and unaware. But what if AI could see, hear, and feel on its own? What if AI had its own senses, like a camera to see, a mic to hear, and a brain to process what's happening around? Then it would not have to rely on our words to understand the situation. It could gather context on its own, which also means that the first input or the first prompt would already be rich, detailed, and accurate. And that alone would make the entire conversation better. On a side note, if the AI can sense and process things locally on the device, it means that the prompts going to cloud are already cleaner, more precise, and more relevant. And that reduces the back and forth. And less back and forth means less load on the servers and data centers. So embodiment doesn't just make AI smarter, it also makes it more efficient scalable, and sustainable in the long run. Okay, now coming back. So we see how embodiment can give contextual awareness. But there's another reason we might be so eager to give AI a body. And that's our own human nature. See, even though all this new AI speaks in natural languages, we are still not wired to talk naturally to a screen or an app. I mean, we kind of use chats for communication, but it's not the same as talking to something in real life, like speaking to a smart speaker or even talking to a camera. It just feels more natural because we are so used to interacting with physical things, and not just interacting, we also get emotionally attached to them. We give names to our bikes and our cars. We feel sad when our phone breaks. We even talk to our plants. So a physical AI is not just functional, it also carries a presence. You feel like it's there in the room with you. And I think embodiment will make this transition from AI being an assistant to AI being a companion. And who's better to make the next generation of companions than the guy who designed the last one, Jony Ive. Recently, Sam Altman had this coffee date with Jony Ive. And for that, he paid a huge check of $6.5 billion. I think that's the most expensive coffee date anybody ever had. But if this leads to the iPhone moment of AI, it might be just worth it. Because if you look at Jony's track record, with the iMac, the iPod, the iPhone, all these were not just devices. They shaped how we relate to technology. And now he's moving into AI. In his own words,
I am absolutely certain that we are literally on the brink of a new generation of technology that can make us our better selves.
Like I said before, the way we interact with the AI right now feels incomplete. And even Sam Altman agrees to it.
If I wanted to ask ChatGPT something right now, think about what would happen. I would like reach down, I would get on my laptop, I'd open it up, I'd launch a web browser, I'd start typing, I'd have to like explain that thing. I would hit enter and I would wait and I would get a response. And that is at the limit of what the current tool of a laptop can do. But I think this technology deserves something much better.
That's why OpenAI and Loveform, AI's design studio, teamed up to create a new company called IO to design a new family of AI-based products. And apparently, they've already built the first one.
Jony recently gave me one of the prototypes of the device for the first time to take home, and I've been able to live with it.
This line, that he was able to live with it, is really interesting. Because we don't want another smart device. I already carry a laptop on my back, a phone in my left pocket, AirPods and keys in my right, a watch on my wrist, a wallet in my back pocket, and sometimes AirPods in my ears. So if this new AI device is going to be a part of our lives, it either has to replace these legacy devices, or it has to fit in seamlessly without any friction. Now, in this intro video, Jony has talked a lot about designing for people, their motivations, and their values. So let's see what they come up with next year. But this takes us to the second challenge of these devices, human-computer interaction. We're moving from a typing-based interaction to speaking-based interactions. Because with these new LLMs, natural language is becoming the way we communicate with these machines. That means more voice commands and more spoken input. But that also brings up a new problem, privacy. See, not every command is meant to be spoken out loud. Some commands need to be just a whisper. Like in an open environment or in public, it's okay to play music or to identify something in front of me. But I don't want to start my navigation loudly because I don't want everybody else to know where I'm going. Typing lets you keep things private. Nobody knows what you're searching or what message you're sending to your girlfriend or to your friend because you can't say everything out loud, especially not in public. So how do you find a middle ground? The extreme version is Neuralink, where you just think a thought and the machine gets it. But that's not happening anytime soon at scale. So if you want to live with an AI in the real world, we need a way to interact that's both natural and private. This might be the biggest design challenge for embodied AI. How are we going to solve it? I don't have an exact answer. Maybe it's ultra-sensitive mics in your ear, so you can whisper a command even in public. Or maybe it's built into your wrist, like how detectives talk into their sleeves. And as Jony and Sam already said, that they're building a family of AI-based products, not one device. So maybe it's not just a single device, but an ecosystem of devices complementing each other. Whatever it is, we'll see next year. But one thing is for sure, that right now we're standing at crossroads. On one side, we have AI, as we know it today, powerful, accessible, but trapped behind the screens. On the other hand, we have embodied AI. AI that can see, hear, and understand the context. The question isn't really whether AI needs a body. The question is, do we need AI to have one? Because right now, AI feels like a tool, something we use and then put it away. But with embodiment, AI becomes something else entirely. Not just a tool, but a presence, a companion, maybe even a friend. I know a lot of companies have tried and failed, but if Jony Ive and Sam Altman are right, this really is the beginning of the greatest technological revolution of our lifetimes. And then the answer to our question might be simpler than we think. It's not about giving AI a face or a body, it's about giving it a place in our lives. That's all for today. I'll see you in the next one. Thank you.